Hello everyone, and today I'm doing my top 10 Doctor Who TV stories. Because I thought I really enjoyed making my top 10 Big Finish audios yesterday, so why not make a top 10 Big Finish, no, not Big Finish audio, TV stories. And if I do sound a bit tired, it's because this is the 25th time I'm recording this. Yeah. So let's start with number 10, The Brain of Morbius. I really like it because I love the idea of another evil Time Lord. Well, we have seen other evil Time Lords before in Doctor Who, like the Master, the Rani, the Meddling Monk, Omega, the Valiant, etc., etc., etc. I really like evil Time Lords because they're cool, I guess. No, I really like evil Time Lords because it feels like the Doctor. It feels like a challenge for the Doctor to defeat them in a very nice way, like. It really feels like a challenge. It really feels like he has to really do something to defeat that monster. Yeah. And the way that Morbius, he was executed, but then of course he has like a lot of followers and stuff, so well, one of his most loyal followers brought him back to life, well, brought his brain back to life, and he's trying to build, well, trying to find like a pet suitable for him. But then that's not, well, that's not a possibility. They use the thing, like the mechanical head and stuff, for Morbius. And the when Kondo, I think that's the name of his servant, realizes that the mad scientist guy removed his arm for Morbius's mechanical body, well, like new organic mechanical thing, that's so brilliant when he's like, "You took Kondo's arm and stuff." Yeah, really enjoyable. Really enjoyable. Great plot. Khan is brilliant, and of course it's gonna return, well, in a couple of days. Well, in 2 days' time. So yeah. Number 9. Survival. Yeah, I get a bit sad every time I watch this because it's the final episode of Classic Who, but it's amazing. I must admit it's amazing. It features Cheetah People, the Master, well, people, well, cheetahs hunting people. Yeah, and the plot is brilliant with the cheetah world and the real world, and the cheetahs being able to, like, teleport between the two when they want to hunt in the Master's plan and stuff. Brilliant. And I think this really deserves to be on the list because it was the final episode of Classic Who. Yeah, it really deserves to be on the list because it's a bit sad that this was the final episode. But yeah, so well, the Classic Who. Of course, we got the new series, but we all know Classic Who is much better than New Who. We all know that. Number 8, The Happiness Patrol. Why is The Happiness Patrol on this list? Well, because it's so brilliant. It's a very underrated story. This is a really underrated story. This is one of the only non-fan favorite stories on the list, but there's a couple of stories that aren't fan favorites. But of course, it's a lot of stories I really wanted to be on the list that were fan favorites, like Remembrance of the Daleks and yeah, and Pyramids of Mars and stuff. But they didn't make it because I could only choose 10, but I wanted to choose a million. So yeah, that's just true. I love the idea, like, people aren't allowed to be sad, and if they're sad, they're executed. And the Candyman is creepy, and I love the way that there's like a patrol walking around in the streets and killing sad people. Oh my god, that's so amazing. I get how some people don't really like it, but I think it's because you have to think about it, and it's one of the more political stories and stuff. I personally love that, but some people might not like that, but that's just because I really like dilemmas and political stuff and stuff. Well, there isn't any dilemmas in that, but I like political stuff and stuff. Yeah. And I think it's so evil that they don't allow people to be sad, because let's all be honest, we've all tried to be really sad at some point in our lives, or multiple points in our lives. And if you have been really sad, you'll know that it's so difficult to, well, hide it. I mean, you can't hide it. It's almost impossible. I mean, I haven't tried to hide it. I've, of course, every time I'm really sad about something, I don't hide it because that's stupid. I don't hide stuff like that. But you'll know if you're sad that it's impossible to, well, almost impossible to hide it. And then if you are forced to do that because you will be executed if you don't. Well, that's just insane. I mean, how brilliant a plot is that? Yeah. But then, number 7. Morgrin Undead. I think the Black Guardian trilogy is very bad. But this is the only... But this story is brilliant. But the two other stories are so, so, so bad. The idea is so brilliant of the Black Guardian trilogy. But the other stories are so bad. But this story is just enjoyable. Because of the, it's the opener to the Black Guardian trilogy. We see the return of the Brigadier. Brigadier Alistair Gordon Lethbridge Stewart. And we see we have a time thing with him where he meets his past self, well, him from like 5 years earlier. And yeah, that's just weird and amazing at the same time. And we see some people trying to be Time Lords. We see the Black Guardian for the well, second time. We saw him in Key to Time trilogy. Well, not a technically not a trilogy. Never mind, the trilogy is only if there's three. And there's more in the Key to Time, so sorry about that. But we actually see him in the Key to Time series, Black Guardian. But this is the second time we see the Black Guardian, and he is really good in the story. Really, really, really good. I mean, I prefer him in the story. I think he's at his best here, even though I do really like him in the Key to Time. Yeah. What else can I say? Brilliant. I like the way that Turlough is trying to kill the Doctor. So he has a companion that tries to kill him. Yeah. That's amazing. Even though after this story, Turlough became really annoying. And the Fifth Doctor's era went a bit down. Well, then it went up again once in a while, but mostly down. And then we got stories like the Five Doctors that were so, so, so bad. Sorry, but I really don't like the Five Doctors. I used to love it, but I just don't like it now. It's only continuous references, really. So yeah. So I think this is the, well, this is when his era started. Well, Peter Davison's era started to begin. Well, start to go bad, I guess. Well, he got another brilliant story, one amazing story, and then he got a couple of really good stories. Like Resurrection of the Daleks, and Sorry Everyone, Words of the Deep, and stuff like that. Yeah. So, number 6, Vengeance on Varus. Okay, still amazing. The way that they basically kill people, well, people have to, well, be executed, really, or, basically, people die, and then it's broadcasted on live television. Death game, well, death... stuff, executions, voting things where you die if you don't get voted and stuff, on live TV, people getting electric shocks and stuff, just for people as entertainment. How amazing is that? I know the Colin Baker era gets a lot of complaints from people because it's too violent and apparently the stories are bad. To be honest, I really like the Colin Baker era. Let me explain. The violence really is really good. And the stories... Yeah, okay, I know. Twin Dilemma isn't really amazing. But to be honest, it's not that bad. And then there's, of course, Timelash. And let's just not talk about that story because it's so awful. But then the rest of the stories, yeah, they're pretty alright. And we have two amazing... Well, actually more. We have quite a couple of amazing stories in his era. Yeah. Vengeance on Varus is amazing. Number 5. Black Orchid. Yeah, I've always really liked this story, but I rewatched it a couple of days ago, and I just realized how much I actually loved it. I used to give it an 8, I think, but I give it a 10 now, because I just rewatched it, and it was so bloody amazing. It's a murder mystery thing. It's only a 2-parter, and it could have been longer. But it's sort of a filler, but it's a filler... But it's an amazing filler, if you know what I mean. It's like a filler that wasn't supposed to be anything special, but it ended up being anything special, being something really special. That's brilliant. I mean, and I really like the way that there's like a Nyssa lookalike. That's great. Well, a person that looks identical to Nyssa. And the where that it's in this, like, there's this party thing, where everything, well, not everything, but where everyone's dressed up, in costumes and stuff. And it's like a murder mystery. That's brilliant. Yeah. Number 4. The War Games. Okay, this is amazing. It's a 10-part epic. The first story to introduce, well, the Time Lords. Yeah. If you don't think a story set, well, basically about some people wanting to find out, well, basically wanting to use humans as slave warrior things, where they make humans from different time zones fight each other, well, fight in copies of their time zones, really, where they make them fight to the death. So there's like a World War II zone and an American Civil War zone. No, not World War II, World War I, sorry. Sorry, I meant World War I zone. That's a World War I zone. There's like a zone that's for the American Civil War. There's one for the Mexican Revolution. There's like a lot of wars, the Romans, and there's loads of wars. And then it's basically in zones. And the warlords are like, yeah, great. What else can I say? Amazing, brilliant, Second Doctor's final story. Don't really like the way that Zoe and Jamie leave, because they get their memories erased. Don't like that, but it's not a bad thing. I just think it's a bit sad, because they were really good companions, and it feels a lot like an end of an era, in a sad way. It feels like the Doctor really loses everything, and he gets set on exile, and you really feel bad for the Doctor. Number 3. We're entering the top 3 now. Cave of Androsani. Okay. Amazing. A war with, well, very complex plot, and about the Doctor and Perry, well, they are about to die throughout the story, because they've been, like, poisoned by the thing, and they have to get bad milk to cure them. Yeah, bad milk doesn't really sound very delicious, but apparently it is. Yeah, that's the only thing that can cure them. And the way that the Fifth Doctor just sacrifices himself to save Perry. And the way that we just see his companions, well, talk to him before he dies. Well, like, he hallucinates and stuff. And the way that one of his final words is basically Adric. And the way that he becomes the root and, well, root Sixth Doctor. It's great. We get the nice Doctor, a really nice Doctor, and we send him to a battlefield. That's really what this story is about. Where there's, like, no escape, really. It's sort of feels a lot like the end of an era in a great way. Yeah. Number 2. The Curse of Fenric. This story is just so bloody amazing. I really, really like it. And yeah, it's another McCoy story. Sorry, but I've put a lot of McCoy stories on this list. The Curse of Fenric. Well, basically, World War II. We had underwater zombie vampire-like creatures from the future. And you get the Curse of Fenric. If that doesn't sound bloody amazing, then I really don't know what does. Oh, it's so brilliant! And the, like, the way that there's, like, sort of, kind of, like, the British soldiers, well, basically, some Russian soldiers, well, no, if you haven't watched it, I'm actually not gonna spoil it, because it's much better if you go into the story unspoiled. But basically, amazing, and it's set during World War II, and I love the priest character, especially when, like, the vampire creatures are like, you're not afraid of bombs falling on, well, one of the future vampire, like, underwater Fenric zombie-like creatures. That's actually a character that we met early in the story. It's like, yeah, but, well, it's actually two characters. They've been turned into, like, those things because they were, like, they went to the beach, and the creatures were on the beach, and it's like, it was like two of Ace's friends, well, friends and friends, two people Ace had a, like, a tiny bit of a conversation with earlier, And they got to turn into vampire creature things from the future. And then they were like, you're not afraid of bombs falling on English towns. You're afraid of bombs falling and killing German children. That's so good. That line is so amazing. And he's like, and he's like lost faith. And he's like, the way it, you feel really bad for his character, really. Yeah, and the characters are so brilliant because we get like different types of character. So we get like the Russian commander guy. He's like a nice guy that believes in Russia, really. And then we get the guy that's unable to move his legs, the guy in the wheelchair, and he's like a scientist guy, and he has a computer. Yeah, he has a very, very, very early version of a computer. Yeah, and then we get the general guy, and we get Ace the doctor, we get the priest guy, we get the two girls that get turned into vampire zombie, like underwater creature things from the future. Yeah, and stuff. We get a lot of different characters, and they're all brilliant. But I'm not gonna let you wait any longer for number one, so what's number one? Well, number one is, of course, the brilliant, the amazing, the almighty story known as the... Nope, sorry, not that one. It's The Two Doctors. Of course it is. Yeah, it's. I know it's not a very popular story, but I really do enjoy it. It could be because I don't eat meat and animals and stuff like that. I'm actually a vegan, so I don't eat animal products. Yeah, that's not the only reason why I love the story, because when I watched it for the first time, I ate meat and stuff. I wasn't a vegan or vegetarian or anything like that, but I am now, so yeah. This story turned me into a vegan or vegetarian or whatever you want to call it. Yeah, because I was like, that makes sense when Chagai was trying to Jamie, really. Yeah, I think it's brilliant. The Sontarans, a bit underused, but they are really good. The Andragums are a great species. I would like the way that the second Doctor and Jamie and basically sixth Doctor and Perry are sort of, they are both in the story. It's like we have, it just makes the story feel big. And I know there's like some continuity problems, but hey-ho, doesn't really matter because the story is so bloody amazing. I sort of feel bad for the people who had to play the Sontarans in this because, yeah, it was like 40 degrees and they had to be inside the Sontaran costumes in Spain. It was filmed in Spain, well, most of the story was. Yeah, and I love the way, like, the Sixth Doctor is so rude to Perry. I love that, the way he's, like, forces her to fish and, it's just, yeah, well, he doesn't force her to fish, but he goes out of fishing, and she's just really bored, and he's like, oh, don't throw rock things into the water, you will scare away the fish and stuff. That's, oh, so, he's so rude, but it's so amazing. I really like the Sixth Doctor. He's a great doctor, because I really like the way that he's rude and stuff. I really like when the Second Doctor gets turned into an Andragum, because I love the way that him and Chaga and the guy, they just want, like, a good meal and stuff, they like, and then Chagai later says something like, the Andragum that's, like, no longer an Andragum, I can't remember her name, but she was, like, an Andragum, but then she was turned, well, she got some things, she's, like, more clever and stuff, she's like, but I was just eaten, and he was like, no, that was just a tiny snack, that's brilliant, yeah. I'm sorry that Genesis of the Daleks and the Pyramids of Mars and stories like that wasn't on the list, but that's because there's so many stories and I could only choose 10. Hope you enjoyed this video. Have a nice everyone. Bye.